Good morning, class 12. So, in our yesterday's class, that is in 12th class, we were discussing about the self-inductance of a long solenoid. And we found that the self-inductance of a long solenoid it was mu zero n square a l mu zero n square a l. So based on this, today let us find out how much energy a long solenoid can store whose self inductance is mu zero n square a l. So for that, as I was telling you yesterday, that when I current flows through a long solenoid, the amount of magnetic field develops inside the solenoid B, that can be written as the developed magnetic field inside the solenoid is B equals to mu zero n I, where for your remembrance, where n is equals to capital N by capital N by L. That means total number of turns divided by total length. Okay? So now what we can write from this? From this, we can write that, so the energy stored by a long solenoid U equals to what we have seen. That is, if L is the self-inductance of any coil, then the energy stored by the coil or the inductor is half Li square. So it is half Li square. Now, if I will be replacing the value of L in this relation, so what we are going to get? Therefore, U equals to half mu zero N square A L I square. So from this we are getting the relation as U equals to half mu zero N square A L I square. Now by using this relation, from this relation what we can write? I equals to B by mu zero N. So let us replace it here. So by replacing I with this value, we can write as, because the I is the instantaneous time, so we can replace it. U equals to half mu zero n square a l b square by mu square n square. So n square will get cancelled. Mu square, so one mu will be cancelled, and hence the final relation we are getting half 1 by 2, or better if I write b square a l divided by twice mu naught. B squared AL divided by twice mu naught. So this is the final result of energy stored by a long solenoid. Now from here, if we will try to find out one more term, that is, suppose as you can see AL, since AL is equals to V, which is nothing but volume of the solenoid, volume of the solenoid, so U by V, so we can define, so it can be defined as that the magnetic energy stored, the magnetic energy stored per unit volume of the solenoid. As U by V. So U by V means what? U by AL. So this will leave V square by twice mu zero. And let us define with small u. So the magnetic energy stored by the long solenoid per unit volume is B squared by twice mu. Whereas if we will be establishing this kind of similar relation for a parallel plate capacitor, that how much electrical energy it can store per unit volume, then from there we can write that, if you can remember, the energy stored by a parallel plate capacitor was, so if I write it for the inductor I UI, then it will be for parallel plate capacitor UC, if I write, that will be a half CV square. Now for a parallel plate capacitor, we all know C, for a parallel plate capacitor the value of C is sigma by it is actually epsilon naught A by B for a parallel plate capacitor, and V can be written as Td, where D is the separation between the two plates. D is the separation between the two plates. Then if I will be replacing this, then what I'm going to get? Half epsilon naught A by D into T squared D squared. Okay? So 1D will get cancelled, and hence we are getting half epsilon naught E square. Now this AD. So this AD is nothing but the volume. So the small u. Therefore the electrostatic energy stored by a parallel parallel plate capacitor. Parallel plate capacitor. Per unit volume. Per unit volume. That is UC by V. Let us also write it with small uc, that is nothing but half epsilon naught E square. So it is also half epsilon naught E square. So for magnetic energy, stored magnetic energy, it is B square by or half B square by mu naught. And for electrostatic energy in the parallel plate capacitor, it is half epsilon naught E square. Thus, from these two relation, from this relation and what analogy we can draw? From these two relations, we can say that the energy stored per unit volume is directly proportional to its corresponding square of the field strength. So we can write that from relation 1 and 2. It can be concluded that the energy stored per unit volume corresponding field strength. Okay. Now we will talk about the mutual inductance. So we have learned about self-inductance, and I told you that in my later classes we will be talking about the mutual inductance. Then what is this mutual inductance? So as you know, in English language also, the mutual term comes whenever there is more than one thing or person with mutual correspondence, with mutual agreement. So this, in this all type of terms, the mutual word comes. So previously, while talking about the self inductance, it was like that only one inductor was involved. So to experience the effect of mutual inductance, we must have more than one inductor. Now let us see how this will work. coil P. I have named both the coils one as P and one as S because I have marked the first coil through which we are allowing the current to flow is our primary coil, whereas the second coil in which the effect, any kind of effect that I will come to after a few minutes I will talk about that thing. So some effect can be observed in the other coil which is kept close to the first one. So I have named that coil as the secondary coil. So as I was telling you that if at any instant suppose I current is flowing through the primary coil, then what we know, it will give rise to the magnetic flux. It will give rise to the magnetic flux in the primary coil. And this magnetic flux, as the magnetic flux is nothing but the number of magnetic field lines passing through some area perpendicularly, that means it will create one magnetic influence around the primary coil, and hence it will when I current is flowing through the primary coil, it will develop magnetic flux in the primary coil, which will be linked with the secondary coil. So the amount of magnetic flux linked to the secondary coil proportional to I, as because this flux is linked with S due to the flow of current in P, so to remove the proportionality sign, we need to put one proportionality constant, and that proportionality constant is known as the coefficient of mutual inductance. Coefficient of mutual inductance. Now, by Faraday Lenz's law, what we know, the induced EMF in the secondary coil, due to this flux link, the amount of induced EMF in the secondary coil, that can be written as minus of divided by, and that is equals to minus of M di dt. So this is the amount of induced EMF in the secondary coil due to the flow of the current in the primary coil. Now, as because it is developing some amount of EMF across the secondary coil, so we will be able to evident a flow of current which will be detected by this galvanometer attached to the secondary coil, and hence without supplying any current to the secondary coil, we are getting some amount of current in the secondary coil. So this mutual inductance actually gives us what? When we are supplying or when we are allowing some amount of current through a coil, then that coil produces the magnetic influence which gets linked with the nearby kept secondary coil, and as a result it develops EMF across itself, and hence a current flows through the secondary coil. Based on this phenomenon, later on we will be talking about the transformer. So this is actually useful. This concept is useful. Primarily, I can give you the example of transformer, which is also in our course. So here, as you can see, this is also what will be the unit of this M. This M is also EDT by TI. So volt second per ampere, and hence the Henry. So same, the mutual inductance and the self inductance both are having the same unit. Only the difference is that in self inductance only one coil is involved. The flow of current develops the magnetic flux in it, and hence it generates a back EMF or reverse EMF, which tries to oppose its cause. Whereas in here also the same thing is happening, but in the other coil, and which as a result gives us a flow of current in the secondary coil. Now from here, when two coils are inductively coupled, so here as because they are kept closed, so some coupling is taking place, that means the mutual sharing of the field is taking place, inductive coupled, in addition to induced EMF produced due to mutual inductance. So what is that? When two coils are inductively coupled, in addition to induced EMF produced due to mutual inductance, induced EMF is produced in each of the coils due to self-inductance as well. So when the mutual inductance will take place, so before mutual inductance, self-inductance will also come in play. So when this self-inductance also has its influence, then the mutual inductance between the two coils having self-inductance L1 and L2, suppose this is having LP and LS amount of self-inductance, then this mutual inductance, the coefficient of mutual inductance will be actually M will be actually equals to K times of root over L1, LP, LS, or if I will be naming it as L1, L2, then it will be L1, L2. Okay. So here, the term you are seeing, K, is known as the coefficient of coupling. This K is known as coefficient of coupling, and its value, the value of K always remains between 0 and 1. It is never greater than 1. So the value of the coefficient of coupling always remains between 0 and 1. So in my next class I will show you how you will keep the two inductors to get the maximum value of the mutual inductance. That means the position of orientation of two inductors will give different values of K, which will lie always between 0 and 1. Okay. till then, please go through the section whatever we have discussed today, and also try to revise your previous chapters along with this one, and keep practicing. Thank you.